We've always been fascinated with waves. They can either be soothing on a calm summer day on a beachfront or as treacherous as a tsunami. They play a major role in coastal erosion and have entertained the surf community for years.
We're going to explore the characteristics of waves and the variety of waves that exist in the ocean environment. So let's get started.
If someone asked you, what is a wave? What is this thing we call a wave? Would you be able to describe it or to tell what it means or what it is? Waves themselves are actually invisible since they consist of energy that's traveling away from its source. So as a wave of energy moves through the ocean, it appears to raise the water above the flat surface as a moving wall of water. Let's start by defining the forces that create or destroy waves. All waves need a disturbing force, which is how the wave is initiated. This can take the form of a wind, a rocking harbor caused by an earthquake, the impact of an asteroid, gravitational attraction due to tides, or any other force that will create a displacement of water. Waves are restored to their original flat state through gravity. Gravity makes waves fall down, if you will. On the microscopic scale, the restoring force for very tiny waves is cohesion, where molecular electrostatic forces break up very small waves like the ones in a coffee cup. We have to distinguish between the energy of the wave that enables it to move forward versus the actual motion of the individual water particles. So if you were a seagull or a person floating on a wave, you would feel the wave draw you toward it as it approached, followed by a rise and a surge in the direction of the wave, followed by a drop and a push away from the passing wave. This full orbit is called the particle motion, or an orbital. Now, as you go down with depth below a wave, the orbitals decrease with depth. Eventually, there's a depth at 1/2 the wavelength where you no longer feel the particle motion. If you think of a sailboat that sways on the surface of the water as a wave passes below, this motion is amplified the higher you are off the surface. So if you're up the mast, that motion is significantly higher than on the deck of the boat. Scuba divers will know that they feel less seasickness if they jump into the water and submerge. As they dive deeper, they'll feel less motion and thus less motion sickness. Now let's look at the components of a wave. We call the highest point of a wave the crest, conversely the lowest point the trough. The wavelength is the distance between two crests or troughs. The wave height is just the vertical distance between the trough and crest. We also have two more definitions that help characterize how fast a wave is moving. The first is the period, which tells us how long it takes one full wave cycle to travel by a point. The second is the frequency. This is just the number of waves passing a particular point each second. Notice that there's an inverse relationship between frequency and period. Now, the speed of a wave is directly related to the wavelength of waves. As the wavelength increases, the speed increases. Tsunami have speeds of 500 miles an hour in the open ocean, where the water is deep, and wavelengths that could be hundreds of miles. Now, as the speed of the wave is decreased, the wavelength also decreases. So tsunami that hit ashore have a shorter wavelength, so their speed must also be slower. We need a few things to get waves going, and that includes wind speed, wind duration, and fetch. The fetch is just the area over which the wind is blowing in the same direction and without a significant change in speed. So if we get these three ingredients with sufficient strength, duration, and area, then we can get the wind that develops into a swell and can travel across the entire ocean on its own. We've already mentioned the very tiny capillary waves that are just a couple of centimeters in wavelength. As wind first hits the ocean surface, the first waves that form are those very small waves. At this scale, these waves behave like the wing of an airplane. So while there's wind that's blowing against the wave, pushing it forward, there's a bit of low pressure that develops behind the wave. This causes the wave to feel an upward lift that acts to drive it forward, similar to the lift in an airplane wing. To get a stable wave height, Waves will generally have a ratio of height to wavelength of about 1 to 7, which gives the wave sufficient support to stay up. Some storms can produce steeper waves, but anything much higher will tend to fall over. Now let's look at the waves we've been waiting for, and that is rogue waves. These are unusual monster waves that show up out of nowhere. They're the biggest threat to oil platforms or container ships. They're the big kahunas of the ocean, and mainly because they're unpredictable and unexpected. In order to understand how rogue waves work, we have to understand the principle of constructive interference and the superposition of waves. Whenever waves collide, they essentially ride over one another, and the total height of superimposed waves is just the sum of the individual waves, as we see with this reflected wave on the beach hitting the incoming wave. It's not surprising then to imagine a multitude of small waves all coming together at the same point to create a very large isolated wave. The rogue wave is defined as an isolated wave that's at least 3 times as large as the background waves. And the damage produced by these killer waves can be catastrophic. In our next episode on waves, we'll cover more wave types and explore their behavior based on their particular ocean setting. I'm Mike Kozik, and this is my Science Blast.